Thank you for joining us tonight. I'd like to introduce Antonio Buehler, who will be guiding us through today's discussion. Antonio started his education and career with the United States Military Academy at West Point with a degree in systems engineering. He served tours in Kosovo and Iraq as an airborne ranger and qualified engineer officer in the U.S. Army. After his service, he attended Stanford University, earning an M.B.A., and moved to New York to work on Wall Street as an investment banker, running a private equity fund. Searching for more meaningful work that contributes to the world, Antonio shifted his focus to education and began teaching middle school and high school. This choice led him to Harvard for a Master of Education degree. He's the founder of Abrome, and you can find out more about Abrome and Antonio by attending the Smart Schooling Book Club on the last Thursday of every month here at Laura's, 6 p.m. Or you can attend a program that he has helped start at the library on Monday nights called Free Play and Food Trucks. And that's more information in the back as well. One other note is that Peter Gray, author of Free to Learn and a mentor of Antonio's, will be leading a series of talks on self-directed learning and the importance of play in education and in life. It'll be this April. So for more information, again, if there's more information in the back of the room. We're very fortunate to have Antonio in our community and have his expertise tonight. So thank you for joining us, and thank you, Antonio.
Thank you. All right. So first thing I want to know is who's in the room. So just raise your hands. That'd be great. Who here's a parent of a young person? Great. Who here is a student? All right. Are there any school counselors? Admissions consultants? Okay. All right. For the schools that you all attend, it looks like there's several. You know, raise your hand if you go to a public school like Lake Travis or Westlake. Okay. And any private school students? Homeschooled students? Okay. Thank you. All right. If you want to, for the students in the room, do you have a dream school that you want to go to? What is it?
Harvard.
Okay.
Yale.
Yale. Okay. Harvard, Yale. Nice. All right. This is who I am. I have 13 years of experience working in college admissions, as a consultant. And I have a really, really successful success rate, really good success rate. And that's not because I have any sort of magical powers or the people who I've worked with were particularly skilled. In fact, a lot of the people that I worked with had lower GPAs and lower standardized test scores than the average of these various schools. It's because college admissions is kind of a game, okay? And that's what I'm gonna talk a little bit about today. But the first thing I wanna talk about is options. So there are many, many options for college. And Harvard and Yale and Stanford are just a few schools in a sea of potential opportunities. And they're not actually that great in the grand scheme of things. They get a lot more credit than they deserve in the higher education world. But they are amongst a crew of sort of elite research universities, right? The schools at the very top of the U.S. News rankings. Then there's a lot of really great research universities that aren't at the top of the rankings. And there's a lot of really amazing liberal arts schools that aren't a research university that tend to get overlooked in the U.S. News rankings. And then there's the top-tier public universities, right? Such as the University of Virginia, right? Really great public universities. But for some reason, in our brand-conscious society, people are really fixated on going to top schools. And so, that doesn't become an option for a lot of people. But then there's a lot of unranked or lower-ranked schools, and those don't seem to be an option for many, especially in schools like Westlake or Lhasa. Then there's community college, right? And I argue, and I do alumni interviews for college admissions, and I tell every single person that I have an interview with that it doesn't matter where you go to school. You can get as good of an education at ACC as you can at Harvard or Stanford. If you go there and you take advantage of the opportunities, you can get as good of or better education than you can at Harvard and Stanford. Unfortunately, that's not what people come to this talk. I don't say how to get into ACC. No one would show up, and it's not very fair. So we will focus on the Harvards and Stanfords and Yales of the world for this talk. But community college is a great option. Then there's the question, do you even need to go to college, right? So even if I did convince you that you don't have to go to Harvard, Yale, Princeton, Stanford, MIT, you know, you could go to a state school or a community college, you know, the question is, but do I even need to go to college? And I would say, for a lot of future pathways, I would say no. You know, you don't need to go to college, right? If you want to be an entrepreneur, college is a waste of time, right? It's a huge opportunity cost. If you want to be a great salesperson, if you want to be someone who can affect change in your community, dealing with social issues, right? If you want to be an artist or an entertainer, right? If you want to work in technology, like these are pathways that don't even require college degrees. And so I think that it's worth asking, do I even need to go to college, or does my child even need to go to college? But again, we're here because people want to get into top schools. This was a video of Elon Musk, and he's basically been asked in this interview, you know, what he looks for in recruiting, what he looks for in recruiting people to his companies, Tesla, SpaceX, etc. And he makes it very clear that he doesn't care about college degrees. Now, SpaceX has certain requirements because they're a government contractor where certain jobs have to be filled by people with certain degrees. But the point is that people who have been very successful, who can make lots of decisions about how they're trying to build companies, or people who are trying to change the world, a lot of times they devalue the
degree. There's a lot of people in the places like the startup world, for example, where if you come in there with a Stanford or Harvard MBA, you're put at a disadvantage in the hiring process because they assume that you think that you know everything, but you probably don't know very much, and you might not be as eager to learn as someone who has doesn't have those degrees behind them. So assuming that your children or you as students still want to go to college because you feel that that you need that college degree for some reason, do you need to go to the top college, right? And so I would encourage everyone in the room to pick up these books, Excellent Sheep by William Derisiewicz, and Where You Go Is Not Who You'll Be by Frank Bruni. This book in particular, Excellent Sheep by William Derisiewicz, I highly recommend it. That's also something I encourage everyone that I interview with for alumni interviews to read, because in it, he's a former Yale professor, and he talks about how so many people come to this Yale, amazingly resourced university, and they have so many opportunities, but they're just so focused on getting in, right? Getting in is everything, and they're trying to do everything that it takes to get in, that once they get there, all they know how to do is to keep playing the same game they played in high school, and they often miss out on the opportunities that are available at Yale. And he argues in a lot of ways that small liberal arts schools are a much better alternative because of the way that they approach learning and because of the way that the class is structured. He argues that you can get a much better education at a small liberal arts school than at schools like Yale and their peers. And I agree with him in a lot of ways. But if you know what you're going to school for and you take advantage of it, you can still salvage your opportunity at Harvard, Stanford, and Yale. All right. So how selective is it? I don't like looking at the percentage, right? Like we know that Stanford accepts less than 5% of the people who apply. I like to look at it this way. Stanford rejects 21 of every 22 applicants. Harvard rejects 18 of every 19 applicants. Yale rejects 13 of every 14 applicants. So when we think about that, what are my chances of getting into Harvard and Stanford? When we think about what they're looking for, I imagine that a lot of people in the room think that this is what they're looking for. They're looking for academic excellence. They're looking for transcripts where you took the most rigorous course load, as many APs and honor courses as possible. You didn't take any easy courses, right? Because you're competing against your peers in a lot of ways. You have the highest GPA, you know, and you take all the weighted classes, so it's even higher. You study really hard for the SAT, so you get the 1600 or 1590. You study really hard for the SAT twos, right? And then you put yourself in the game. And then on top of that, you have to do all the extracurriculars, right? And so you take as many extracurriculars as possible. You're doing clubs, you're doing sports, you're doing community service, right? And you can't just take them. You just can't, you know, be in the French club. You got to be president of the French club. You got to be vice president of the student body. Am I right? Right? Like that's what everyone thinks getting into these schools is. But that's not really true. They're wrong. So what they're really looking for, I'm going to cover in this talk. But there's certain things that actually help you a lot more than just doing what everyone else is doing. Right? Does anyone know what hooks are? Hooks in the admissions game? Tell me what a hook is.
Basically something that various universities are like looking for, such as being an athlete, legacies, underrepresented minorities.
Yeah, you got it. Yeah. So hooks are things that help in the admissions process, right? And he mentioned three: legacy, athlete, underrepresented minority, right? There's also faculty children, there's development cases, and there's VIPs, which I call president, governors, senators, children, children of Fortune 500 CEOs, children of like movie stars, rock stars, etc. I'm going to go through each of those, but I'm going to use Harvard as sort of like the example as we walk through it. Why? Because it's Harvard, right? Everyone loves Harvard. And so we're going to use Harvard as an example. None of these schools will ever open their books to the general public and say, this is how we approach the admissions process this year. We had a target number of this, a target number of this, and a target number of this. They'll never say that because they want to keep it black box. They want to keep you guessing, and they want to fool people into believing that they have a much better chance of getting in. So you submit your application, so you increase the number of applicants, so you decrease the acceptance rate, so that they can increase their U.S. News ranking, right? So I will make some assumptions, but all the assumptions that I make are based on publicly available information, that has come out over the years. So some of it's going to be based on stuff that might have happened 10, 15 years ago. Some of it's going to be based on the last admission cycle, okay? Feel free to ask me any questions about the numbers afterwards. All right, so how selective is it to get into these schools? So we said, for example, 21 of 22 people get rejected from Stanford. What was it for Harvard? 18 out of 19, something like that? Yeah. So it's a 5.2% acceptance rate last year. Did you know that? Yeah. Do you think that's good? Do you think you have a fighting chance at 5.2%? Yeah, it's pretty challenging. What I'm going to argue is it's actually much harder than that for people without hooks. And I'm going to walk you through that. Stanford, coincidentally, for like the last 4 or 5 years has had the lowest, right? So Harvard historically has had a lower acceptance rate than Stanford. But like 4 or 5 years ago, Stanford overtook Harvard. And, it used to be like 30 years ago, Harvard-Yale were always fighting for students, right? Now it's like Harvard-Stanford. And Yale feels kind of bad. They're like, hey, did you forget about us? All right. But still a great school. Yeah. Lots of presidents went there. All right. So underrepresented minorities. Does anyone know what an underrepresented minority is as opposed to a minority class, right? So minorities are non-white applicants, right? Racial minorities. Underrepresented minorities are non-white applicants that are not Asian, right? And so I see a lot of Asian people in the room. And so there is an advantage for people who are applying that are black, who are Hispanic, and who are native, indigenous, or Pacific Islander, Hawaiian, et cetera. They have an advantage in the admissions process. There was a study that was done in the late 90s that they tried to quantify that advantage, and they were able to do that in various ways. The only group that was disadvantaged relative to whites, all things being equal, same exact extracurriculars, same exact class ranking, GPAs, were Asians. Asians had a 30% lesser chance of getting in if they had the exact same profile as a white student who got in. And that has most likely increased since then because the Asian population has gone up and hyper competition has increased. But for Harvard, with the acceptance rate being 5.2, I made an assumption. I don't know, if you assume that the yield is relatively even with the general yield of the population, 8% of the underrepresented minorities who applied got accepted. Is that a great chance? I would say no, that's not a great chance, but it's better than 5.2. I'm actually a big fan of affirmative action policies because I think that can help deal with past wrongs in our society, but it certainly doesn't help Asian applicants. They've also done some studies where they've argued that while affirmative action does hurt Asians, right, it doesn't actually hurt white people. White people actually do quite well under affirmative action, even though that's not the narrative that's out there. All right, and just last year, 51% of the class at Harvard was from minority groups, and 29% of that was from underrepresented minority groups. All right, then there's recruited athletes. And this is one that I think people just don't appreciate how much of an advantage it is in the admissions process. So everyone knows that if you're a great basketball player or a great football player, that you have a better chance of getting into these schools. But getting into these schools as a recruited athlete, your chances go way, way higher than it is if you're an underrepresented minority. Basically, the borderline cases that they allow into these schools are the athletes in often cases. Now, at schools like, at Harvard, Stanford, Yale's of the world, they do have academic standards. So no matter how good of an athlete you are, you still have to clear a certain bar. They're just not going to let a lot of people in. But Harvard has 40 sports. Harvard has 40 sports. How many sports do you think UT has? Harvard, UT has 20 sports. So UT has half the number of sports. UT also has something like, they have almost 40,000 undergrads, right? Harvard has 6,700 undergrads, right? And so if you think about what the recruited athlete population is at Harvard relative to UT, it's huge, right? Up to 20% of people at Harvard play a sport, right? And the last number I saw was 11% of them were recruited athletes. So, one out of every 9 students at Harvard is a recruited athlete. That means they have a tremendous advantage in the admissions game. So I said acceptance rate is 65% if you're recruited, if it's someone that they're targeting, and they tend to target you because you clear a certain bar academically. So what you can see in this chart that I'm building is, I'm showing you what percentage of the class falls under these categories, right? And then if you work your way across, it shows you how many applications were received and how many people were accepted based on that. So already, just on underrepresented minorities and on recruited athletes, we have over 800, right? Over 800 people in a class that's only 1,600 strong, right? What does that tell you? If you're not an underrepresented minority and you're not an athlete, your chances are getting much smaller, right? So it's no longer 5.2%. All right, and I didn't even talk about walk-ons. So walk-ons also have an advantage, just not as much as recruited athletes. And then there's legacies. Legacies have a much bigger advantage than underrepresented minorities as well. And there's a lot of really great reports that have come out about what type of advantages legacies have. But 18% of the class at Harvard is made up of legacies. That means that they have one or two parents go to Harvard. That doesn't even include siblings. It doesn't include grandparents. Just one or two parents have gone to Harvard. And they have a huge advantage. The last numbers I saw is they have three to four times chance of getting in than someone who doesn't have a parent who went to Harvard, right? And so 3 times 5.2 is, it's not much, but it's still huge. Would you rather have a 15, 16% chance or a 5% chance? Exactly, yeah. All right, so that's another, 309 students enrolled at Harvard. So as you can see, we're very quickly getting far away from that 1,600, 1,700 number of people who are enrolled. Then there's the development cases, or the VIPs, right? These are children of very rich families. So who here is worth more than $400 million? All right, you're not a development case. I don't know what the cutoff is, but they want people who are going to donate lots of money. You know, they want people who will, you know, fund the next library, or, you know, endow a chair, you know, in some department, you know, upgrade this football stadium, something like that. And VIPs, you know, who in the past couple years had, you know, perhaps the best chance of getting into any school that she applied to? Obama's daughter, right? Like, he's the ultimate VIP. He's the president. He's a super celebrity, basically, right? Now, I heard that she's a wonderful young lady, very, very smart, worked very, very hard, right? But her chances of getting in versus someone the exact same profile who wasn't the daughter of the president, vastly different. You know, so these people make up, you know, I estimated 5%. At some schools, you know, just development cases, just the rich people make up 5%, like Duke University, right? You know, up to 5% of classes, just children of rich people that they accept solely so they can get money in the door through additional contributions. And then there's schools that really prioritize VIP children, like Brown University and USC. They love, you know, children of celebrities and movie stars and whatnot. So, you know, it doesn't seem like much, right? 5% of the class, right? But that's 84 less students. That's 84 less spots that are available to the people who aren't VIP, development, recruited athletes, etc. And does anyone know what the number one advantage is, except for being the president's daughter? The number one advantage when it comes to applying to college, to these elite universities, it's faculty children. Faculty children have the easiest path into these schools. Why? Because they fight for faculty. And if my child, if I'm a star professor at the business school, and my kid applies to Harvard and doesn't get in, but Stanford accepts him, and then Stanford comes knocking on my door and says, hey, do I want to move out to Stanford? I might just be disgruntled enough to say yes. Goodbye, Harvard. You had a question?
Yeah, because my husband is also a faculty. Mm-hmm. He has a lot of friends at the school. They said that's not true, and that's why.
That's absolutely true. Harvard even admits it. So Harvard admits it. Stanford admits it. I mean, like, it is true. It's a tremendous advantage. Now, some people will say that that when you look at it, that because they're professor's children, that they're going to be better students. But this has been debunked over and over again. So the last numbers I saw was that at universities sort of Notre Dame level and above, you know, the acceptance rate for those faculty children are often 80 to 90%, right? For Harvard, I said Harvard's a higher bar than Notre Dame, which is a great school. I said 80%. So your friends are misleading you, because it's absolutely an advantage. It's the biggest advantage. The former dean of Stanford University, associate dean of admissions, John Ryder, specifically said, if there was any hook you could have, it's being a faculty child. So you can take it up with Harvard and Stanford. So when you look at this, and then there's overlap, right? There's obviously, there might be a VIP whose child is also a recruited athlete, right? Or a development case whose child is a recruited athlete, for example. You know, so there's going to be overlap. So what I did was, because we know about half the class is taken up with people with hooks, I just assumed that there were 265 people that were overlapped in some way, right? So I just struck that out of the number. So to get to 50% of the class. So you have 850 slots left in the class, right? And then if you think about it, the acceptance rate is no longer 5.2%, it's 3.2%. Now you, instead of having 39,000 people competing for 1,700 spots in the school, which is what you thought it was gonna be, now you have 29,000 people competing for 850 slots, right? That changes the game a lot. All of a sudden, you know, the stuff that they tell you in the literature isn't exactly, I'm not going to say they're lying. I'm just saying they're not being completely honest, right? All right. So when you're in that group of 850, what are they looking for? Do they want a valedictorian? Like, does valedictorian carry a lot of weight? What do you think?
Some weight.
Some weight? There's 850 slots available in the Harvard class. There's 37,000 high schools in America every year. So does being a valedictorian give you a good chance of getting to Harvard? I would say not being valedictorian doesn't help, but being valedictorian doesn't really help either, right? They're looking for a few things. They're looking for academic excellence, right? So you still have to perform academically, but it's not sufficient. They're looking for diversity, right? Because they're trying to build a class that is very unique and has its own flavor. They're looking for people who come from all different parts of the country, all different parts of the world, people who have different life experiences. Like, they want to create a diverse group, right? Because they don't want a bunch of people who look the same. And that's really hard at these schools, quite frankly. And then they want intellectual vitality. And this is the secret to getting into Harvard and Stanford. Intellectual vitality is the one thing that, you know, most people can't exhibit on the application. And intellectual vitality is just a commitment or a dedication to being in the world and learning and enjoying the process of learning, you know, pursuing intellectual endeavors. And it doesn't have to be academic to be intellectual, but this is what they're looking for. And unfortunately, you know, most people who are in schools, you know, that are very competitive public schools, you know, everyone's trying to get to the top. Everyone's trying to outcompete their friends. And in the process, they're not exhibiting intellectual vitality because you're just doing what everyone else expects you to do. You're not showing that you have this unique desire to learn about the world and to create things. So, admissions is a game. You know, you have to understand that admissions is a game. It's not fair and it's not a meritocracy. Consultants make a ton of money advising students who are applying to schools, because they know it's a game and they know how to manipulate the game to some degree to improve the chances of getting people in. I mean, I don't know when the trend started, probably 30 years ago, but parents got really involved in the admissions game, really coaching their kids through the process. You need to do this, you need to do this, why aren't you doing this? You know, really encouraging and pushing their kids. You know, and so that's increased the stress on the kids a lot. Hasn't exactly helped them get into these schools. And then because the students are convinced from such an early age, especially those who go to competitive schools, that they have to compete, outcompete their friends, they spend so much of their time padding their resumes. And so you can do that, right? But the chances aren't that great. You know, you can fight with all of your classmates to get to the very top in the hopes that you're going to be competitive for these schools. But I'm telling you that just doing that isn't sufficient. And it's probably not going to help you get into these schools, you know, if you just work really hard and outcompete everyone in your local school. You need to decide if that's the game you want to play or not. So now I'm going to talk about the pyramid structure of society and why playing that game doesn't make sense. So I argue that that we live in a society that's structured like a pyramid in every way, right? For GPA, for example, right? If you want to be the best, right? What's your GPA got to be? I know it, you're probably on a percentile thing, weighted, so you need to be like 108, whatever. But just like for the old people in the room, 4.0, right? Like, that's what we thought, 4.0, straight A's, right? I know you guys got weighted things. It's way worse now than it was 30 years ago. But you have to be at the top of your class, right? Whether it's 108 or 110 or whatever it is, right? You got to be at the top of your class. What does it mean to have someone at the top of the class? It means everyone else is below them, right? And so so if you're at the top of your class, you're doing okay, right? That looks good to these schools, right? If you're not at the top of the class, what does that say? You can't rise to the top. That's a big problem, right? You know, at different schools, that means different things. At these really exclusive prep boarding schools, you know, maybe it's okay to be in the top 20%, right? At these really competitive public schools, maybe it's okay to be in the top 3%. You know, if you're from a school out in West Texas, there's only one option: be at the very top of your class, valedictorian. right, to even be in the game. How about SAT? What do you want to get on the SAT? 1600, right? And then everyone beneath that makes up the rest of the pyramid, the base of the pyramid. You can't be at the top unless people are under you, right? Does that make sense? Same thing with extracurricular. It's not good enough to be in student council. You gotta be president of student council. It's not good enough to be on the soccer team. You gotta be the captain of the soccer team and make all league, right? You gotta get to the top of the pyramid. That's the pyramid structure of society, right? So I said 1580 or above. It depends what you're shooting for, right? So you can play the game and try to be at the top of the pyramid, or you can just lead a remarkable life, right? And you're an individual. You're not competing with anyone else. Like, you don't have to stand on other people to get to the top. Because if you lead a remarkable life, you individually are doing something pretty amazing. And I argue that that is the best way to get into these schools. Now, I'm going to stop here for questions really briefly. We're already 30 minutes in. This is where I usually tell people to come to my next talk, where I talk about how to get in or how to lead a remarkable life so you have an easier pathway to get into these schools. But I just want to stop at the admissions talk right now. Does anyone have any questions about the admissions process before I move on? Okay. All right. So how do you lead a remarkable life? The goal is not to rise to the top of the pyramid if you're not going to play the game, right? And by not playing the game, you actually improve your chances, right? Because what are schools looking for? Academic excellence, which they have plenty of, right? There's so many people who fit, check that box. Diversity, something you can't really control. You are who you are. Your parents controlled that, right? But you don't control it. And then, to some degree, you control it. Like, if you have like a really unique and passion or something, that adds that tweaks diversity. But intellectual vitality, that's the thing, that they're looking for that they don't have enough of. Remember, they only have 850 spots in the class. They're trying to be a world-class university. They're trying to be a place where people come together and share ideas, right? To have these great conversations in the classroom, on the sports field, in the houses, right? But they only have 850, like, hopefully they got it out of the kids with hooks, right? But they need those 850 from the general population to really, create that academic environment within those schools. So I argue that by leading a remarkable life, you can hit that sort of measure of intellectual vitality, which is what they're really looking for. All right, so instead of trying to get the perfect GPA, the perfect SAT, all the extracurriculars, I say, let's focus on components that help us lead a remarkable life. Number one is happiness. I know, I just saw eyes roll. Happiness doesn't matter in the admissions game. That's why I don't let my kids sleep 8 hours a night. That's why I'm taking all the AP courses, whatever, right? Happiness matters immensely, okay? I always point out that money does not buy happiness, and then I do this video of Tasho where he says, yeah, money might not buy happiness, but you can buy a wave runner. And have you ever seen someone unhappy on a wave runner? Answer is no, right? But I'm going to skip that video today because we're running out of time. Money helps immensely up to a certain point. So they've done multiple studies on this, but the last one that I saw was in 2010, right? If you have $75,000 a year, you hit a point where you're kind of okay. You don't have to worry about no health care. You don't have to worry about where you're going to live. You don't have to worry about how you're going to get your next meal. And once you have certain things covered, which, by the way, is twice the per capita GDP, right, in the U.S. But once you hit that point, right, the extra dollar doesn't actually make your life better. You don't get happier going from $75,000 a year to $750,000 a year. You can buy more things, but you don't actually get happier, right? So what does affect happiness past that threshold? Another study shows that the variance in happiness between me and you, for example, right? The difference between us in happiness comes down to genetics, circumstances, and mindset. 50% of it is genetics. And that's stuff that we supposedly can't control. Although that's not 100% true, right? You know, there's the ways that our genes interact with our environment that can affect that. You know, but in general, we can't control our genetics, right? But that controls 50% of the difference between me and you. Then there's circumstances that control about 10%, which is a lot less than a lot of people thought, right? But you know, where you're born, your race or ethnicity, the financial conditions of the economy that you might graduate into when you're 22, you know, whether you have family as a safety net, these are things that can affect your happiness. But it's only 10% of the variance. 40% of the variance is mindset. And this is stuff that we can control, that we can control pretty well. And so they identify three ways that you can fundamentally change your happiness. The first one is thankfulness or gratitude, being thankful for what you have. And so people who simply wake up in the morning and acknowledge what they're thankful for, they're actually happier. And so this is a very simple practice that everyone can do. And when you wake up in the morning, what are you happy for? Oh, glad you're here. What are you happy for when you wake up in the morning?
A comfortable house.
There you go, a comfortable house, right? I mean, you're happy that you have a loving family, that you're not homeless, right? That you're alive. There's lots of things to be happy for, even though you want more sleep, right? And so when you wake up in the morning and just saying, I'm happy for these things, as opposed to, oh God, I wish I had more sleep, can actually change your happiness in a positive way. The second part is being part of a community, right? And this, unfortunately, people who are really busy as students and trying to get to the top of the pyramid, they have a hard time doing this. But you know, some can find it in a church group or on a sports team or in a certain club, right? A big part of it is like the family community. Do you have a family that actually sits down and have meals together? Or is everyone too busy for that, right? If you can actually, you know, just have meals, regular meals with your family, that actually will help tremendously. And then doing things for others, right? And so if I'm focused on my personal happiness, you know, sometimes it might seem counterintuitive that I should focus on helping other people. But that is actually a huge contributor to your level of happiness, is what are you doing for others? How are you trying to help others? So the first step to leading a remarkable life is happiness, right? And we can control some of that. The second part is accomplishment, right? And this is what a lot of people think. If I accomplish a lot of things, I'll be happy. Particularly academic, you know, get great grades, graduate the top of my class, go to Harvard or Yale, you know, and then get out of there and go to McKinsey or to Yale Law, right? And then go down the right pathway professionally, and in the process make boatloads of money, right? Like that's how I'm gonna be happy. I'm gonna argue that there's one more measure of accomplishment that we should focus on, and that's contributing to the world in some way. So for me, I did focus on those other things. Like as Autumn said, I was the first in my family to graduate high school. I went to West Point, Stanford, and Harvard. I was checking all of those boxes when it came to academics. And then, you know, because of the structure of society that we live in, you know, the narrative that we have is if you do all that, if you two graduate at the top of your class or your children graduate at the top of their class, then they're going to get into Harvard or Yale or Stanford. And then they're going to be set because then they're going to get the best jobs. You know, they're going to get into the best grad school. Like that's what we believe, right? It doesn't work like that, right? In a pyramid structure society, there's a small number of winners and a ton of losers, right? And even at Harvard, right? You have the winners, and the winner bracket takes up more space, but then you have all the people who didn't do things at Harvard, and all of a sudden they become losers in some way. And that's why people who have very successful resumes often have midlife crises, right? Lots of people have them, right? But, you know, because at some point, you know, you can only get to the top of the mountain so many times, right? Now, you can beat the odds. You might be that, you know, you might be the next Supreme Court justice. I don't know. But, you know, there's only so many mountains that some people can climb, right? And even the people who do win, even the people who do stay at the top, right? I'm thinking about like people who become managing directors at Goldman Sachs, for example, right? They have won in all the games that they played in. But they're often burned out. They're unhappy. Three times divorced. They don't know their kids, right? They might have a lot in the bank and they might have great resumes, but oftentimes they're not very fulfilled in the process. Peter Thiel has a great quote, "All Rhodes Scholars had a great future in their past," right? Who is the best coming out of college, right? It's the 36 people that get Rhodes Scholarships. Everyone's trying to get it, right? To some degree, everyone's trying to get it. Thousands of the top students across the country apply for the Rhodes Scholarship. Only 36 get it. But then you look at the long-term history of the Rhodes Scholars, and you're like, what happened? Some are like Bill Clinton and become president, but many more, you're just like, what happened to them, right? So they all had great futures in their past. They were at the top of the pyramid, but once they got to the top, then they had to fight to get to the top of another pyramid. And that game is a game. Like, if you have a 1% chance of getting to the top of the pyramid, you're all great students. 1% times 1% times 1%, trying to get to the top of multiple pyramids, chances get pretty slim pretty quick. All right, so this is just another illustration of the pyramid structure of society. Some people want to go to an Ivy League school to get into McKinsey so they can get into Harvard or Stanford Business School so they can get into like Bain or KKR, after business school. Some people want to go to an Yale undergrad so they can get into Yale Law School so they can get a Supreme Court clerkship, and then work their way up to the Supreme Court someday, which there's 9 of. So this is pyramid structure society. It's a bunch of pyramids that start stacking on top of each other. So in terms of the professional aspect of my focus, and I'm using myself because it's easiest to talk about myself because I don't know y'all. But professionally, I did the military, which was very standard after West Point. Then I went into investment banking. Then I did private equity because these are things that, you're just supposed to do, right? Like, if you're on the business track, at least, these things make sense. And if you do these things well, you're going to be extremely successful. That's the idea, right? Financial is often a mix of academic and professional success, or at least that's what we think, right? If you do really well in school, you go to the right schools, and then you get the right jobs, and you work really hard in those jobs, and you rise to the top, you're going to be taken well care of, financially. That's the idea. And that's often true. If you are constantly fighting to get to the top of the pyramid, oftentimes you'll benefit financially, because in our pyramid structure of society, what happens, right? Those at the top capture a disproportionate amount of the economic surplus that's created, right? That's why they have the saying, the rich keep getting richer, the poor keep getting poorer. That's what's happening. The rich are getting richer because they're taking in more of that economic surplus, but that doesn't necessarily mean that they're happy, and it is a small number. Okay, I argue instead of focusing on academics, professional, and financial accomplishment, we should instead be focusing on contributing to the world. And there's many ways to contribute to the world. And again, this is counterintuitive. If I'm selfish and I want to be happier, I focus on myself. No, if you want to be happier, you focus on giving to other people, right? And in terms of accomplishment, instead of measuring myself on what college do I get into, or what are my grades, or what job do I get after college, instead focus on how I'm contributing to the world. Am I trying to deal with a major social issue? Am I trying to help the homeless situation, for example? Am I trying to, help save the earth, right? These are ways I can contribute to the world. Am I starting a company that actually makes people's lives better, right? There's a need in the market somewhere, and by filling this need, I'm contributing in a positive way to the world. Am I creating knowledge for the sake of humanity, right? Like Albert Einstein, right? Was he successful because he was a professor, right? No, I mean, like the way that he, I imagine that he was quite fulfilled in his life, at least at certain points, because of what he was able to contribute to the world through the knowledge that he discovered. And then, I can also contribute by, through art, making the world more beautiful. There's many ways to contribute, but notice none of these measures of accomplishment require getting to the top of some pyramid. It's not about getting, beating everyone else out. It's just me contributing to the world in some way. So my focus on accomplishment, personally, is I focus on education and police brutality. And I'll go through this real, I'll try to go through it quickly. So education-wise, when I was in New York, I was doing investment banking. I was like, I don't like this. This is no fun. This is kind of like the military. Very miserable. You're just taking orders. You're working long hours. The only thing better about investment banking in the military was you got paid a lot more, and you didn't run the risk of getting shot, right? But other than that, investment banking was still pretty miserable for me. So I started a private equity fund called Trophy Point Capital, and I was looking for charter management organizations or curriculum providers to buy and run, because I wanted to be in education. Through the process of that, I came to realize, for me personally, that I could not buy an education company where I felt that I wasn't going to hurt more children than help. I thought that if I played into the way schooling is set up in our society, that I was going to hurt children. Even if I was the most empathic, humanitarian type of CEO possible, I was going to hurt more children than help. So I decided, instead of hurting children, I was going to focus on do no harm. And I actually picked up and moved to Austin, Texas to try to help people find different alternatives than the pathways that they were going down. I didn't have a business plan. I didn't have any income. I didn't have any customers. But this was immensely helpful to me personally in terms of me feeling like I was leading a meaningful life. So once I moved to Austin, unfortunately, I had an incident with the police. And I might be the only person that talks to you ever about getting into Harvard and Stanford who will also say, I've been arrested a bunch of times, right? So on New Year's Day 2012, I was driving home. I was a designated driver. I pulled into a gas station, and I observed a woman being abused by a police officer in downtown Austin. I started yelling at the cop to stop. I tried to take pictures. The cop came after me. Next thing I know, I'm arrested, and I have a felony charge of spitting in a police officer's face, which is a felony that carries 2 to 10 years in prison. This is a video of it. I don't want to do it because it takes too long. Luckily for me, witnesses came forward to say, I was there, I saw it, it didn't happen. One person took video of the incident, and so all of a sudden, people rallied behind me. I got media coverage, and through the process, I had a lot of people come forward to tell me their own personal stories of abuse, and I was like, whoa, like police abuse is a real issue, right? And I didn't know that previously. So I took the people who rallied behind me, and I started the Peaceful Streets Project. It's an organization that combats police brutality here in Austin, and it has extended outwards. We've done a lot of good, since it was launched in 2012. I personally spent tens of thousands of my own money on it, and remember, I moved to Austin without an income, right? So it wasn't exactly helping the bank account. But in the process of being sort of an activist against police brutality, they arrested me 5 more times. Fortunately, I beat all the charges, no convictions, but it's because we had video every time. I filed 3 civil suits against various police departments and police officers. I've helped at least over a dozen people be found not guilty for crimes they didn't commit because we actually filmed the incident and those cases got thrown out or they beat it in trial. And I've helped at least a half dozen people file their own civil suits against these police departments. And, we've helped push forward the idea of cop watching and the police accountability movement in general. So, this was an example of me really trying to contribute to society, trying to make the world a better place. And in a lot of ways, I never felt happier than doing something that was completely outside of myself, just trying to help solve a major problem for millions of people in this country. But I knew that my real passion was education, and I wanted to get back to education. So I went back and I got my master's degree at Harvard, and I came back to Austin with a goal of helping many more people than I can through police brutality issues through education. And I launched Abrome. And Abrome is just a private school. I'm not going to say it's any better than any other school. We just have a different way of doing things. But this is the way. This is a way that I continue to contribute. So I'm not trying. Now, technically, I have those degrees: West Point, Stanford, Harvard, right? And so I was going down that path, checking the boxes, and I was going down the path of doing, getting the right jobs, and doing the right jobs. And I was on a path to make a lot of money. But none of that stuff really made me feel good about my life. It wasn't until I really dedicated myself to contributing to the world as my measure of accomplishment that I started to find, you know, more happiness or purpose in my life. And when we're contributing to the world, it's not a competition, right? If I'm trying to help students, for example, through my school, you know, my goal is not to be better than all the other schools. I actually work with other schools to help them be better, right? Because the goal is actually helping young people lead better lives, right? When it comes to police abuse issues, my goal is not to do more work than everyone else or get the most accolades. I want as many people doing the work as possible so we can deal with these issues, right? When you're contributing to the world, it's not about getting to the top. We don't need to get to the top of the pyramid. Everyone can contribute, right? Everyone can make a difference in the world. And the thing is when we all focus on that as our measure of accomplishment, there's no pyramid to get to the top of. All of a sudden, we're leading a more remarkable life. Happiness, accomplishment, and then meaning. Meaning is the third component of leading a remarkable life. And contributing to the world, which we just talked about, you know, gives life more meaning. Meaning is about contributing to something greater than oneself, right? Meaning is very different than the other measures of accomplishment, right? It's better than happiness even, right? Happiness is fleeting. You're happy in a moment, and then that goes, right? You know, if you become valedictorian of your high school, that's great in the moment. But then it goes away because then you're one of 1,600 some students at the college that you go to, and then you have to compete again, right? But if your life has meaning, that's enduring. That's with you always, as long as you continue to lead that life of meaning. So for the parents in the room, you know, there's two pathways for your children, and we already talked about it, right? You know, you can go down the pyramid path, like the pyramid structure of society approach, right? Where you just want your kid to be the best. Get to the top of your class, get the best grades, get the best SAT scores, be in the most clubs, be president of the club, start your own club even, you know, find some way to start your own club, you know, be in the various sports, etc. The problem is that is going to hurt far more children than it's going to help. You know, this is a snapshot that I took when Deb Stepak, the former dean of the Stanford Graduate School of Education, came to town, and she was talking about expectations for success for young children, right? You know, this is just 3- and 4-year-olds, 5- and 6-year-olds, 7- and 8-year-olds. And just in those short, you know, 4 years, right, you went from not over 90% of those children believing that they were going to be successful in school. When they came back and measured them 2 years later, that dropped down to 70%. Only 70% of 5- and 6-year-olds actually, or 80% actually believed that they were going to be successful in school, right? In kindergarten, already we had 20% assumed that they weren't going to be successful. And then 2 years later, when they're 7 and 8 years old, only 6% of students felt that they were going to be successful at school. Why is that? It's a structure. It's a pyramid structure, right? And they learn very early on where they are in that pyramid. And as the years go by, more and more people realize that they're in the base and they're not at the top. And so, you know, I think that we should try to free them from that type of feeling where they convince themselves that they're not good enough and where they're going to be judged based on where they are in that pyramid. Instead, I say let them pursue a remarkable life instead of trying to get to the top of the pyramid. Happiness, accomplishment, and meaning. Happiness. You can eliminate oppression within their lives to include the parents if necessary, right? You know, the way that the parents like really try to control the children and make sure the children do everything right. Now, taking away the oppression does not mean taking away the challenges, right? People can still lead very challenging lives and they can have challenging situations, but you don't need to add oppression on top of the challenges, right? I encourage unlimited free play. Autumn talked about Peter Gray. He's coming to town. He's going to give a talk at Abrome on Wednesday, April 25th, and he's going to give a talk here on April 26th, and then he's going to give a talk at Clearview Sudbury, which is an alternative school in East Austin, on the 27th. So three nights in a row, he's going to be in town talking about self-directed learning and free play. All three are free events. I encourage you to all come to them, and they're going to build on each other. We're also covering his book, Free to Learn, that month in the April book group. And so I encourage you to come read the book and come to that group, because unlimited free play is extremely important, even for teenagers, okay? Give them agency over their lives, or allow them to have agency over their lives. And that's something that they don't have, most likely, right? They just have a schedule that they're sticking to, and they're doing everything that they think they're supposed to do. They're trying to please you, or they're trying to please their teachers, or they're trying to do whatever it takes to get into the top schools. And most likely they don't have agency over their lives. They're not making their own decisions as to what they want to do with their time. And so that has a huge impact on happiness. And since there are so many Asians in the room today, relative to when I usually give talks here, I do want to point out that of all demographic groups, Asians are the only groups where stress and anxiety and depression escalates with time. In every other group, it actually decreases as they get towards the end of high school. But with Asians, it spikes tremendously. I think it does for affluent white people as well, but they didn't break out affluent versus non-affluent white people. And then lastly is spend time with them. And I know it's hard, especially in this area. We have so many professional parents who are working, you know, jobs that require, you know, constantly being tied, you know, to email or whatever. You know, both families are professionals oftentimes. But you got to spend time with them. Don't outsource that opportunity to spend time with them. And, you know, in particular, you know, if you can just have dinner with them every night. Now, they might be at a point now, if they're old enough, if you've never had dinner with them before, like, you know, it's not a regular thing, they might say, "Mom, Dad, I don't want to have dinner with you." You know, so it's better to start when they're young. But, you know, spend time with them. Try not to outsource that, because, you know, at 18, they move on, and you're going to lose that opportunity anyways. You know, but that's how they can be happier. Accomplishment. Take the focus off of academic, career, and financial success. Ignore everything that they're focused on, that they're being told to focus on, right? You know, if they need the top SAT scores to get into the certain schools, they're going to know that. They don't need you to remind them of that. You know, they understand that perfectly well. Instead, allow them to define accomplishment for themselves, and let them know that accomplishment can be contributing to the world. Find something you care about and contribute to the world as your measure of accomplishment. And then give them the time and space to do that. Don't overschedule them. Don't have them involved in a bunch of extracurriculars where you're constantly driving them, you know, first to soccer practice, then to piano practice, then to do community service time, right? Like, give them the time to actually pursue, you know, what they want to pursue. And then meaning. Allow the children to find the opportunities to contribute to society in ways that are relevant to them. That will help them find meaning within their lives. But it has to be intrinsic. It can't be something that you assign as a task. You can't say, "What are you interested in, son?" And the son says, "Oh, well, I'm interested in, you know, developing economies and how we can, you know, use, you know, different, you know, government practices to improve that." Well, then you as a parent shouldn't say, "Great, let me go set you up with an internship with a congressman so that you can do some work on it." No, you gotta let them do it. All right. So we're almost done. And then we'll open it up for questions. But if you want your child to lead a remarkable life, let them focus on happiness, accomplishment, and meaning. The variables of happiness that we can most control are circumstances and mindset, right? Can't control genetics too much. Circumstances, right? Place of birth, race, ethnicity, gender, sexuality, etc. These things we can't control a lot of, but there are things that we can control. For example, if our children are in a bad place, you know, we can allow them to change the context. We can allow them to leave that situation. So one big one is bullying, right? If they happen to be bullied at school, for example, that's something that they don't, that's a circumstance, but it's something you have control over, right? You can pull them out of the situation that they're being bullied in and allow them to pursue a different pathway. That's a real option, right? If you're making them you know, take piano lessons, because darn it, I spent 8 years on piano lessons for you and you're not quitting now, right? That's not the best way to go. The best way to go is say, well, what do you want to do? And let them go. It's a sunk cost anyway. And then mindset, thankfulness and gratitude. That's something that you can control directly as young people. Wake up every morning and acknowledge what you're lucky for. Like, you know, you have so many advantages in life. Just acknowledge those. Those are tremendous. Be part of a community. Find that community, right? If you're not part of a community, find a community. Parents, definitely, please, at least eat dinner with your kids to create that community at home. And then finally, do things for others. It's the opposite of selfishness, right? But it also will help you drive more happiness into your life. Change your measure of accomplishment to contribution, right? Focus on that instead of academics, professional, and financial. And then focus on leading a meaningful life, right? Try to find a way to find meaning within your life. And if you can do this, you're going to lead a remarkable life, right? When you do things for others to be happier, you're also contributing. And when you measure that as your measure of accomplishment, you're going to keep doing things for others. That's going to make you happier, all right? Your contribution as an accomplishment is going to lead to a more meaningful life, because you're doing things for others. You're trying to make the world better for some other people. That focus on leading a meaningful life is going to allow you to be more thankful for what you have. You're going to have more gratitude in life. You know, that's huge, right? These all play into each other. Two pathways, everyone has that. And not everyone can be at the top of the pyramid. By virtue of pyramid, very few people can be at the top of the pyramid, right? You can play the game and try to constantly get to the top pyramid. It's not healthy. It doesn't make people happy. It doesn't give them meaning in life in most chances. Most people can't get into Harvard and Stanford. However, the easiest way to get into these schools is to lead a remarkable life. If you lead a remarkable life, you're going to hit that measure of intellectual vitality, and you're going to stand out in ways that you cannot as a valedictorian, right? What schools want is they want intellectual vitality and they want interesting people. You lead a remarkable life, you're going to do that. And you're going to have a tremendous advantage in the admissions game. Remember, you can excel whether or not you go to college, right? College, if you lead a remarkable life, if you're leading a remarkable life, college doesn't become an automatic, right? You have meaning in your life, you're leading a remarkable life. You don't have to go to college to continue leading a remarkable life. You're already on path where you have meaning within your life. You're contributing to the world. You're doing good for yourself and for others. But those people who lead a remarkable life, if they go to college, they're much more likely to take advantage of those opportunities. They're much more likely to take advantage of all the opportunities at Yale, or at least as many as they can like take advantage of. They're not going to be the people that William Derisiewicz talks about that squander the opportunity, right? It's not 13th through 16th grade if you're leading a remarkable life. But the thing is if you lead the remarkable life, your chances of getting into Harvard or Stanford or Yale go up tremendously. You're no longer at 3.2% or 3.5%, right? All of a sudden, your chances go up tremendously because this is what the schools don't have. They have 37,000 people who graduate at the top of their class every year. They have very few people who demonstrate intellectual vitality. Out of the 850 kids that are vying for those general open pool slots, they want kids with intellectual vitality. They want people who are leading a remarkable life. And so it's that simple. And I tell people this every single year. I encourage parents to allow their children to lead remarkable lives. I encourage young people to stop playing the game and focus on leading a remarkable life. And very few people listen to me because they're scared. And they believe that they have to get to the top of the pyramid in order to succeed because everyone else is trying to get to the top of the pyramid. It's not true. I've helped over 50% of the people that I've worked with get into Harvard or Stanford. You can do it much happier, much healthier, with much less stress, and you can still have better outcomes in the process. So focus on leading a remarkable life. Don't focus on getting to the top of the pyramid. And that's my talk. I gave you the secrets. You can call up Harvard, Stanford, or Yale and ask them to verify whatever I said. They won't, but trust me, that's the best way to go about it. Or take a job there as a professor. Any questions?
Could you give
So, yeah, that's the thing, is everyone can lead a remarkable life, right? And so if I give you an example, that's sort of like, oh, so that is like a path that I can go down, right? Like, that's someone I can emulate. But the thing is, when people are leading remarkable lives, you know, it there's 360 million people in America? 360 million people could lead remarkable lives. It's not about getting to the top. It's about finding something that they really care about, some way that they can contribute to the world, and then doing that, you know, with passion. And if going to Harvard or Yale is something that is a part of their pathway, then they're going to do the things that matter in terms of SAT scores and whatnot. They're going to say, okay, this is what I need to do. I need to clear this academic excellence bar, so I'm going to do that. But I'm not going to waste my time trying to get to the top of the pyramid in the way everyone else is. I'm going to focus on leading a remarkable life. And so I don't want to give examples because it's not fair to the, you know, countless ways that people can lead remarkable lives. Like, what are they interested in? What do they want to do? What do they see as problems in the world? What do they see as opportunities in the world? You know, what do they really care about? You know, when they're young kids, they want to play, they want to run around, they want to play video games. When they become adolescents, they want to date, they want to hang out with friends, right? But somewhere along the line, if you give them freedom to pursue their interests, they're going to get really interested in something. And then you allow them to do that with all of their effort and to invest inordinate amounts of time in it. And then they become an interesting person. And if they focus on contributing to the world in some way, you know, then they're going to really stand out. And that's going to, that, and it doesn't have to be huge. They don't have to create an NGO that raises $10 million a year, right? They can do it on a very local scale where they're contributing in a meaningful way. It's possible. But I don't want to give sort of like an example, because I just think it's unfair to the many ways that people can flourish. Anyone else have any questions? This could be the fewest questions I've ever gotten at this talk as well. Yeah, so Abrome, we're a very unique school, right? And so we don't have classes, we don't have grades, we don't have class rank, we don't have age segregation, we don't have teachers, we don't have instruction. You know, we're a place where people come and engage in self-directed learning, where they can do whatever they want with their time, as long as they're honoring basic community values, such as don't hurt yourself, don't hurt others, don't hurt the community, right? And we give them the time and space to do that. But that's something that families can do even if they don't go to a learning center like Abrome, right? You know, they can unschool, for example. That's a real opportunity. And then there's people who don't have the option of unschooling or sending their kids to a learning community like ours. But they can encourage their children not to get caught up in the game at school. They can encourage their children to really pursue stuff that interests them. And so that way they avoid the stress of trying to be constantly at the top of their class. Now, if they want to get into Harvard and Stanford, if they're not at the top of their class, that's a strike against them, right? So the best thing to do is to have them be in a situation where they're not being graded and they're not being ranked, you know, so you want to take them out of that pyramid structure if possible. But, you know, I'm not here to talk about Abrome. I'd be happy to talk to you about Abrome afterwards. I'm here to encourage you to consider there's two paths for your children. They can, you know, fight to constantly get to the top of the pyramid as a way to do what everyone else is trying to do to stand out, or they can actually lead a remarkable life, which makes it very easy to stand out.
Thank you.
Yeah, my pleasure. All right, thank you.